I'm Dr. Delene Webber, and I'm the Program Director for Environmental Science. I've got Dr. Barb Coth in the audience back here, so she can answer any questions or add to if you like, Barb. And two of our fabulous students, Tara and Leo. And I know we're paid by the university, so you don't trust us as much, but you can trust our students who are doing the degree and can give you a student perspective of it as well. They'll keep us honest. So yeah, as I said, we're going to talk about two different degrees. Now, they're interrelated. We're both in the same school, and both these degrees, it's the same first year. All right, exactly the same first year courses. So if you actually want to swap between the degrees after you've experienced them a little after first year, that's no problem whatsoever. Okay, and I know lots of people are concerned. Who's a little bit anxious about their choices? No one. You're all totally confident you're going to make the right choice. Okay, and it's one thing to recognize at university as well. It's not the end of your life if you make the wrong choice. It's definitely, you can transfer between universities and you can transfer between degrees, and it's really not that hard. Okay, and you can get credit and everything else as you do that. So, of course, when you start with us, you won't want to transfer. All right, what stands out in our programs? First of all, what students love and why we think it's a really good environmental program. There's obviously a lot of choices in this area in Australia as a whole. We have strong practical component, okay? Now, some people are teaching environmental science, for example, using online courses, but it's really hard to replace the actual value of getting out into the field, getting your hands dirty, actually really understanding what plants grow where, why, you know, trapping wildlife and understanding how you do different different procedures in the field. So we do have strong field work. So we have camps and lots of project-based. We have lots of connection with industry. About a third of your courses would be taught by industry experts. And all of your other courses taught by actual full-time staff, they're all research-active people that are working intensely engaged with industry. Our program's been developed in consultation with our advisory committee, and our advisory committee is top CEOs and executives from across the state in both private and non-profit, private non-profit and public sector, and they've helped us to create a program that's really about giving you the base knowledge in four distinct areas. So you need to have some good understanding in ecology and biodiversity, in landscape science, so things like geology and soil science, in geospatial sciences, so mapping, for example, and human dimensions, so for example, social science and psychology. And we've done this because most problems in the environment aren't just one facet, all right? We haven't been able to solve things like climate change because if we just go at it from a geological perspective, that doesn't take into consideration, for example, you know, people's behaviour, what motivates you to turn off your lights and take the train instead of a car. So we need to attack these problems from a multidisciplinary approach, and that's where our program is different from other environmental programs. We're really trying to develop critical thinking skills and good decision making, good project management skills as well. It is a small degree, which is great. It means we all know you very well and can help you through your degrees. We only have about 100 students in environmental science starting in first year and about 25 in geospatial science. As I said, we're all very research active in our area. UniSA was rated under the Excellence in Research in Australia. We were given a 5-star rating in environmental science. That's the highest rating you can get in Australia, the only ones in the state. So very strong. Our research institutes are the Barbara Hardy Institute and the South Australian Water Centre for Water Management and Reuse. Our first year, as I said, is common for both degrees, and you can get more information on all of these programs on our website, so I want to leave time for questioning and not go into this too much, but as I said, you're getting a bit of a splattering to start with to build everyone a nice base knowledge because you've all come in from different backgrounds. In physical sciences, like landscape fundamentals, is a basic geology course, some biology courses, planning courses, and some in human dimensions. And you also start with a course in environmental analytical methods, which gives you some basic stats, which is really important for building your research skills too. than to talk about specifically environmental science. And again, both are three-year degrees. For this one, there's no prerequisite subjects or assumed knowledge. When we get to the geospatial, you see that there is, with the maths being a prerequisite and physics being assumed knowledge. The ATAR is 61.5, and I'd just like to comment on that. The ATAR is the lowest entry rank into the course, because we have some parents sometimes decide that we don't want to do that course because it's too low an ATAR for you. We have people with ATARs up to 100 doing the course, all right? And in fact, we'll give you $5,000 if you've got an ATAR over 97 automatically, all right? We want high-achieving students. So the range that, you know, the mode, the most common score is quite different from that as well. So, and it stays around there. It's stayed between 60 and 65 for several years now. So I would expect it to be around there again this year. Second year courses, you do ecology, you do some more mapping, you do conflict and consultation. Now, this is another one that differentiates us from most environmental degrees. I don't think you can work in the environmental field without there being controversy. Okay, so actually giving you the skills as to how you can handle that, how you can handle public consultation and work with people with very different views is really important. So you do that, do global experience where you learn about protocols of different countries, you learn networking skills, so it's very good for careers, that particular one, but it's also good if you're going to work outside of Australia. And you start doing some basic law in policy and regulations. In our integrated field study, you work on a real problem with industry and that requires you to put together your knowledge from the first year. It requires you to do mapping, it requires you to do some biological inventory, requires you to understand the soils and understand the human context of the problem. And in the third year, you start to get more electives, so you can start choosing some of the areas that you're most interested in. Do a little bit on Aboriginal perspectives of the environment in caring for country. You learn about public communication and environmental interpretation. And you learn about risk management in landscape hazards. And again, more electives then. And I'm going to turn it over for Leo right now to tell you a little bit from a student perspective on why he thinks it's a worthwhile course.
Hi everyone, my name's Leo. I'm a half desk, half man student at UniSA. Oh, I thought I was going to get more laughs than that. Oh well. Anyway, myself personally, I'm in my final year at in the environmental sciences degree. I guess 3-4 years ago I was sitting where you guys are sitting now, and now I'm talking about my degree, so that's, I guess that's a big change that's happened in my life over those years. The first thing I want to talk about is the sort of the friendships that you build at university. And this is true of all universities, this isn't specific to UniSA. But because everyone kind of comes into it, everyone's quite anxious, very nervous. I mean, you get people straight out of high school, people coming in from the workforce. Everyone's kind of, it's like a mixed box, everyone's jumbled around and everything like that. So you make friends really quickly because everyone doesn't really know what they're doing yet. And yeah, so everyone's in the same box. So you make really good friends. And it's also, you know, you make potential contacts for future employment through that too. Also, it can be quite challenging. Sometimes you're put out of your comfort zone, like giving a speech at Open Day or running a mock-up consultation event in front of a bunch of people. So again, this is true of all universities, but you've really got that good opportunity for personal growth by really being forced out of your comfort zone, whereas you might not do that otherwise. This is sort of the last thing I kind of want to talk about, and this is sort of, I would say that if you look at the universities and their environmental science type degrees, you know, they're broadly all of the same sort of quality, but the thing that makes UniSA different is that the focus on, well, sorry, I'll say what I said before, because in my first speech. Traditional universities are very good at producing one type of person, and they are very good at this, so I'm not trying to badmouth them, but they're very good at making university professors. And I'm not saying that's a bad thing because I like my professors, but I don't want to be a professor. So UniSA is not a traditional university. It's got a very corporate, aggressive kind of culture to it. And it's one that tries to imbue students with a professional confidence and competence so they can enter the workforce and have the skills ready that they need to. You know, they might not know exactly what they're doing there, but they have the confidence to learn how to do what they need to do. And if you take anything away from my sort of short talk that I've just given, I'd like it to be that is the difference between UniSA and other universities, and I think it's really important. Thank you.
And this is Erin that's up on the pictures. She's one of our students working as an environmental educator over in Thailand now. And I had her on, we do a field study at the end of our third year that students can go on. Erin was on that last time I did it, but Barb's this year taking our students on that field study to New Zealand. And they'll go over to New Zealand for 2 weeks and work for the Department of Conservation there. They're doing some very excellent work, for example, in trail management, and they're working with the Department of Environment, Water and Natural Resources here in South Australia, and they'll talk to them, consult with our state government department afterwards, and talk about sort of what good things are being done in New Zealand that might be able to be applicable to South Australia as well. So we do lots of things like that. It set the students up well from a career perspective because it starts to build their network and really build their confidence in realising that they do know how to solve complex problems. And we do, of course, because some of us do want to go on to be university professors, we do have an honours degree that you can go on to in fourth year, and you can also do a master's and PhDs. In terms of employment prospects, because I know that's something that interests lots of people, we're still, most of our students are probably going with state and local government, to be honest. There's an increase in federal government jobs, but sometimes not enough motivation from students to move to Canberra. Those jobs are there. We have lots of people working in local government as an environmental officers, and in lots of different, in particular the Department of Environment, Water and Natural Resources, but we also have, this year we've had quite a few going to the EPA as well. Private sector also employs quite a few people in as consultants or in the mining industry. Nature-based tourism operators, example. Some people have started their own businesses as well. And we do have people interested in working for not-for-profits as well, being the three typical ones, land care, conservation volunteers, trees for life. A couple of years ago, we had three different people take UN jobs. We haven't for a while, but we have people working for the IUCN as well, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. And we do have a percentage, about 10% of our students stay on to do further research. In terms of the geospatial science, I won't go through the first year because that's exactly the same as environmental science. The ATAR this year is slightly higher. It's a very small intake, so that will vary a little bit more than the environmental science one. Again, it's 3 years, but there is that prerequisite of maths and there's the assumed knowledge of physics, which is an awkward way of saying you don't actually have to have it, but we would like you to have at least read a little bit about it because it will really help you in your course if you've got some basic sort of physics knowledge. So in this particular one, less electives, and you have to do physics. Still, you'll see quite a few of the same courses with the geospatial data acquisition and the environmental conflict, but a few more specialised courses. And again, there's that maths course, also really important. If you want to work in the geospatial area, really important that you like numbers and you like working on a computer. In third year, again, some similar courses and a little bit of opportunity for electives there. In terms of what makes it good, in this one, and this is an example of one of our students had an ATAR of 100 that works as a marine surveyor. I'm going to pass it over to Tara, actually, to talk about why she thinks this course is fantastic.
Okay. Well, I actually came into the environmental science degree, and the first year, one of the core courses was geospatial course, and I got into that and just discovered that I really, really loved maps and found it to be incredibly fun, and you got to play with all the latest technologies and use really cool computer programs. So I decided that geospatial area was probably what interested me most, along with a lot of other friends, like Leo was saying, that we all sort of found in our first year what topics we really, really loved, and then that basically made for the electives that we chose in our second year. I actually really like this degree though. I haven't actually swapped over to the GIS one. I'm still in environmental science, but I actually think that's one of the best things about this course, is that I can actually stay in the environmental science and do all the sustainability stuff that I'm really interested in, but also do all the GIS electives so that I can get a job in GIS further down the track. So for as far as job opportunities go, there's basically two avenues, which I think as a mature age student really appeals to me, rather than just being one direct line down the middle and that's all you can do. I'd have to say too, that just from the UniSA perspective, what's available, I suppose it comes down to you as an individual of what you make of it, but I'm actually fortunate enough that I will do that global experience topic in second year. I will do it in Vietnam over 2 weeks instead of the full semester, because I applied for it through the global experience and was successful to be able to go and do that, which I think is an incredible opportunity. I've been able to go overseas other times during this year, so I will have actually gone overseas 3 times by the end of this year for uni. So I think I never thought that would be a possibility coming into uni. And I really think that that's the UniSA thing, that the lecturers are so approachable. I've heard from other friends that lecturers at other unis sort of stand down the front and tell you and then walk away, and that's all you see them once a week, whereas I can approach mine all the time. They give me guidance, they answer questions whenever I have them. They've been able to point me in the right direction industry-wise. I'm heavily involved in the GIS industry. I go to conferences all the time. I have heaps of contacts. I sit on the Young Professionals Board for the SSSI, and that's all because, you know, I've basically just gone and said, this is what I'm interested in, and they've made it happen. So I'm not sure, I mean, I've never been to another uni, but I'm not sure if that happens at other unis, but I can certainly say that that's probably, the lecturers will probably be the reason I come out of this degree with a job as soon as I leave. So, yeah.
Thanks, Tara. Thanks, Leo. And yeah, to follow up on that a little bit, I guess we do have our foundations as a university, as a teachers' college. So we do really care about student learning outcomes. And I think any good researcher should also care about undergraduate student outcomes, because undergraduate students are the future. So we are really approachable, and I guess I like to take this opportunity as well to tell students that, because if you do come to, regardless again of what university or what degree you choose, it is really important that you don't think, you know, that university is this big isolating environment where academics are up in their ivory tower, and that you do, we're just people the same as your teachers at secondary school. And if you're struggling, if you come and see us, because we do offer some really good support services through the uni and tutoring and counselling and all sorts of other stuff. So it is important to, you know, drop into our offices and say hello, and if you're struggling, let us know so we can try and do something about it before you have any problems. Okay, and again, in the geospatial area, and geospatial, for those, because I don't think I even explained it at the start, for those that have no clue what geospatial is, it's the science of mapping and modelling the Earth. So, you get to use the equipment like the total station here, it's a theodolite. And we do, again, we've got the, you can do honours, the same honours degree. And you can, a lot of people interested in the geospatial degree actually want to be surveyors. All right, it's the only accredited surveying course in South Australia. We have a massive shortage of surveyors in South Australia, so we really want people doing going on to the Masters of Surveying. A very high paid area with lots of jobs, so that's always attractive. But you do need to, again, you need to be good maths, physics area to be able to do that. And again, as well as our Masters in Surveying, we have a Masters of Environmental Management and Sustainability, and we can do PhDs and Masters by research in this area. And for this area, the employment opportunities are really similar in terms of federal and private sectors. Local governments all employ GIS people now. And probably a little bigger section going into private industry in the spatial, geospatial sciences and environmental sciences as surveying consultants and into the mining industry. And depending, the mining industry is one that sort of booms and busts a little bit, but when it's booming, they'll employ their own surveyors and GIS people, and when it's not as booming, then they'll employ consultants to do that work. So either way, they have certain legal obligations that require work to be done in that area. If you are able to get straight into the degree, you can also look at a diploma of science and technology, and you can apply online for that. And that's offered through UniSA College, and that will get you into the second year of the environmental science degree. So it's a bit of a backup option. Other things which I pointed out earlier as well, there is an automatic scholarship now for high achievers, which is $5,000 for people with an ATAR of 97 or above. And there is also equity scholarships. So if you're interested in any of those and finding out more, that's all on our website as well. And there's still the bonus point system that all universities are doing as well these days, so you can have a look at that on our website if you want more information also. Other than that, I really want to leave the time available for your questions.